affordablerealestateinvestments.com, where I teach you how to find affordable investment properties with confidence, hard work, and a little peace of mind.
Hello, this is Lisa Phillips, and welcome to affordablerealestateinvestments.com. This is podcast 000, or episode 000, and what I want to explain is who I am and discuss, as the title suggested, I do make $975 a month in income from a house that I paid $13,000 for. What I'm going to tell you is that it's not a fluke, and it's a formula that is easily repeated over and over again, and I'm doing it today. The reason I'm giving you this knowledge, because it's a very affordable way for hardworking, regular people who aren't born with a lot of money or have access to a ton of cash, can do it with a little ingenuity and a little hard work, but confidently fulfill those dreams of creating rental income. So I have four rental properties at this moment. They vary. Some were, you know, one bought for $11,000, one bought for $13,000, one for $25,000, one for $35,000. So you can see the progression, however, of the prices, but all basically under $35,000. It's very repeatable. I live in Arlington, Virginia, and I'm still able to do this sort of rental investment just fine, even though I live in one of the most expensive cities in the world. And I want to explain what I did. So each property is different. And in my later episodes, I'm going to explain to you how to recreate this success. I do, the property that I paid $13,000 for, that one's located in Baltimore in a revitalization area that's still ongoing. And that is $975 a month in rent. When I tell people that I paid $13,000 for it, they think, wow, what, it must be crackhead city. No, it's actually a really nice neighborhood. It was a foreclosure. There's just some things I've learned about certain neighborhoods where the foreclosures will go almost next to nothing, even though in a slightly different neighborhood with the same demographics or crime statistics, it will go for way more. But that's in a later chapter, and I'll tell you how to navigate those so you can see where you get good value for the lower price. When I tell people about the $13,000 house, or when the contractors are fixing it up, they're flabbergasted, and I was like, there's more in this neighborhood. And it's funny because by the end of the year, that one took me a year to rehab. All other four houses that were empty were purchased and bought and fixed up and rented out. So it's amazing the effect you can have in a community where when you go, everyone else comes and runs in after you. And then all of a sudden, the value just shoots up because a little bit more investment was made because you made the first move. So that property took a year to complete because I did not have a ton of cash. I knew I wanted to fix this house up. I knew it had a lot of potential being a mile and a half from the John Hopkins area, but I knew it was still an area that wasn't up to par yet. The reason it took a year is because if I didn't have the money, I'd have to save up out of my paycheck by being very, very, very frugal to get the money. So if I had to wait a month or 2 months to pay for the furnace or the air conditioning or the carpeting, I would sit there and wait the 2 months. I'd save up as much as I can, and I would plop it down as soon as I have it. I and my boyfriend went down there every week, every Saturday, and we worked from 8 to 8. It was hard work because of the lack of funds. I had to do a lot of the work myself. However, it worked out because not only did I learn, and he did too, a ton about rehabbing houses and houses as an investment. But, you know, you learn how to save money and how you don't need $15,000 all up front to do this. Some people wouldn't even start, so they don't do anything. And 5 years later, they look back and they have nothing. And my approach and what I've learned is what I want to show you is that you don't have to have everything up front. You just have to have a long-range plan. And when you buy a house at $13,000, the stress level or stress factor isn't as high as if you would have bought a $200,000 house that you're trying to make a profit with. So because of that leeway, I was able to take my time, do it right, and I learned a great deal about houses. I learned so much that, you know, each subsequent house, you know, I'm able to just go in there and size up immediately. on the cost of repairs because they've just been through it on so many different levels. The methods I show you utilize the internet very heavily to even qualify which properties you want to use, the major MLSs as well as smaller to even get there. And you'll hear when I go through MLS listings, you'll hear my ideas of what I would be concerned about, what I wouldn't be concerned about. And if you're interested in real estate, you can gain a lot of knowledge just from that on your own. So that property I've had for a year and a half, and it's doing great. I have a great tenant who happened to be a corrections officer. So, you know, the neighborhood gets buffed up a little because of the work that I did going in there. You know, because it was a lower income neighborhood, I was really worried and scared about crime. And so you Google, you know, how to protect yourself, and you take precautions, and you go there and use those precautions, and nothing happens. It's really safe neighborhood. You know, if I would have let fear and perception stop me, I wouldn't have went in there. So that's a really good performing asset. I'll talk about the other house. This one, in Ohio, I purchased for $35,000. That's making $700 a month of rent. So it's 20% plus a year return on investment. The good thing about that one is that it was also a foreclosure, a HUD foreclosure. I don't necessarily look for real estate owned or foreclosed properties, but it just happens that those continuously show up and will be in, you know, some will be in quite solid condition and definitely worth the money. That one's performing very well. All of these properties utilize property management. I just do not have the time to oversee everything myself. So that's property number two. In a great part of, right outside of Columbus, it's 15 minutes to downtown Columbus. And it's an excellent long-range performing condo, two-bedroom, one-bath condo that I have there. The next house I purchased was $11,000, and I will start work on that this August. And that is because I wanted to wait. The neighborhood was a little sketchier than the others. However, right across the street is a revitalization zone. So I also go in my later podcast that you really want to listen to is, if you're going to choose these houses in these areas, go where there's already money or investment slated to go into it. So if nothing happens, you still have your cash flow immediately. But, you know, that extra perk is what's really going to give you more appreciation, as well as just the more demand and people rushing to the front when, you know, they do this $1.8 billion revitalization like they're doing in Baltimore near the Johns Hopkins University. So that one's on hold until August, strategically, until it breaks ground. And I'm very happy to say that I got in for $11,000. Now you can't buy a shell on that block for under $50,000. And the work's not even done yet on the $40 million school that they're doing across the street. So it's just another example that the strategies that I use are very strategic, and they do work because it basically follows the money or follows what's already invested. And the last property I am working on right now, that's in Richmond, Virginia. And that one I paid $25,000 for, and I'm rehabbing it now. So this rehab is $25,000 for the fix-up, so it'll be a total in for $50,000. However, because of my experience on the previous two, I used 70% of that wasn't even cash. It was financed through Home Depot, Lowe's, Wells Fargo Home Projects Visa, and it's also a strategy I use for my future rehabs and strategy. So out of pocket was a lot less, and the beauty to that is that, you know, if you take my tips, you don't need to have a ton of money to get these things done. You can have contractors do it and get it financed through their particular line of credit, and you don't even have to come out of pocket. And these lines of credit are a lot easier to get than a bank loan. I mean, 10 times easier. How hard is it to get a Lowe's card? I mean, unless you have really, really bad credit, you know, you can get it and get a nice high limit and just keep asking them. I also put tips on how to get them to raise your credit limits, things to say, how to do it, and how often you should ask. So please keep tuned to the credit one so you can see how to build those lines of credit. So at this moment, for this particular property, I'm only using about $17,000 line of credit out of the whole $25,000 renovation, but I have $36,000 available, And you can, between those three different companies, and you can get the same thing too. You do not have to have great credit. So that is what I do. This is my goal. Some may say that I only have four. Maybe I shouldn't say anything, but I will tell you my four has been through hard work, blood, sweat, and tears. No money was given to me. I had to really just be creative when you're back against the wall, knowing you have a goal and knowing that you have to go forward on it some way. So you make things happen. You figure out different financing schemes. You figure out how to figure out which house would be the best bet, how to get money to make these repairs, and how to protect your property from neighborhood that you're not quite, you know, that's lower income. It isn't bad, but you want to protect it because things, you know, might get stolen. FYI, nothing has gotten stolen yet. So knock on wood. However, you know, there's one perception of these neighborhoods are quite different from the reality when you're on the ground. When you're on the ground, you look around, you're like, this isn't scary at all. I don't know why more people aren't doing this. But let me tell you, there's tons of houses available. I don't have enough money to purchase them all. That's why I can give this knowledge freely, because they're sitting out there waiting for you. The people I find who are interested in this are people who want to get involved in real estate, but they're not sure who to trust. The advice I give you is free. I'm not necessarily asking you to pay for this. It's also based on experience. You can listen to any of my podcasts, and you can decide whether or not you want to listen to me if you believe me and you trust in the knowledge and experience that I give to you. And once you go from there, I'm going to give you the rules. I'm going to lead you to the water. I'm going to show you how you can afford it. Anybody can afford it. Not only, I mean, everyone I come in contact with can afford it. And they can start building a foundation. This isn't a get-rich-quick scheme. This isn't some trick to the system. This is, let's very logically look at what we have, use logically what we know, and embark on that. And then with a little hard work on your part and a little courage and guts, not too many courage and guts, but just the fact that to get started on a business takes guts in this society for some reason. So I want to be able to give you that start so that if you look into it, even if you don't get a house under $30,000, although I'd recommend it because the cash flow is so fantastic, you know what to do. You know what to look for, and you have confidence in yourself because you've seen exactly what I've seen, and you know someone's walked you through it, so you've gotten that guidance. You've gotten someone to talk about how they size up houses and what they look for. And, you know, I do rely on other team members. I do rely on getting an inspection. I do rely on structural engineers at times if, you know, I see some foundation problems. However, you know, what I can give you is that basic sense of confidence. And I'm going to have a couple of podcasts where I walk through a house and I show you what I was looking at and what I didn't look at, and maybe that can help you, not only if you're buying a rental property, but your own house. Sometimes it's such a black void, and you don't have anyone to do it. Because I spent the time on all these houses doing the work myself, you know, you just learn about houses, how they fix, and I can talk to a plumber in a better way. And, you know, those are skills you should have. You should be able to talk to a plumber or an electrician, know what they're talking about, respond, say, you know, I thought we had to try this because this was the issue. So that's who I am. I do have a full-time job, so I also have a few podcasts telling you how I manage that hectic schedule. Like I said, last year it was going up there every Saturday at 8 o'clock, coming home at 8. You know, it would have been different if I would have had more access to credit at the time, which I didn't, so I had to just use my own paycheck. This time it's, I work remote one day a week, so it's going up there on the Friday. However, if I didn't go up there, I would go up there Saturday. But this one, because I have all the established lines of credit with different contractors, which I will tell you how to do, I'm only up there for like 2 hours just to check up on things. So it's an hour and a half there to Richmond, hour and a half back. The Baltimore house is taken care of with the property manager. If something happens, they just let me know. So I'm not traveling up there as much. And in a nutshell, that's it. So I have a full-time job as an IT consultant, and I like it because it pays the bills. But it pays what bills it pays is my real estate investing. So right now I'm working on building up these four houses. My goal was one a year, which I think anybody can easily obtain with a little hard work. When they get home from work, if they search through the houses, they go look, they start putting their money, start thinking of financing, talk to the contractors. They can do that. You can easily do one a year. And what I would say is just stop waiting for the ideal circumstances. Stop it, stop it, stop it. I don't know what else to say. It's never going to be ideal. It's like me. I didn't have to start this blog to teach you what I know until I had 10 houses. No, I have 4. I have a lot of experience on that 4. So I'm the type of person that's just going to go and show you what I've done, even though it's not 10 or 15 and I'm not Donald Trump. I think something I've learned in this life that I could pass on to you is stop waiting. Stop waiting for things to be perfect, or else you're going to be 10 years from now and not have done anything because you're waiting for things to be perfect. And I mean, I don't feel like that's true happiness. When, you know, 10 years later, because you thought it had to be perfect, so you can show your friends. You know, this business isn't about your friends. And actually, you know, if you do get started in real estate investment, there's going to be times where you're going to have to choose between your friends and your real estate. There's sometimes, you know, quite a lot, especially doing the house in Baltimore, going up there every week. I just did not have time to go out with friends, and I couldn't go out with them because they were, you know, spending tons of money at the bars. And I'm like, look, I need to save that extra 100 to 200 or 50 or 40. I mean, those $30 tabs add up, you know, and I use that money to fix the house. So, I mean, you just need to understand this isn't about your friends. You know, there are sometimes they wanted me to come out for a weekend trip or this or that. I couldn't go, and that was it. And I'm glad I made the decision that I put my business first. However, it is a conscious decision. So know if you're going to embark on that, you need to know that's coming. So hopefully you have everybody in your family on board, because you're going to need it, because you're going to be saying no to things. You're going to be sacrificing. And good, you should sacrifice for something you want. Nothing should be that easy. The easy money gets in trouble. And we've all saw that in 2008. A lot of easy money and a lot of people messed up, including myself. So that's why I started, you know, this other way. So I was limited to the 35K and under houses because of lack of access to credit lines, but that was something that was affordable. However, now that I'm doing it and I'm making great profit, like this Richmond house, I might be in for $50,000, half, most of that line of credit where it's 2 years free financing. But, you know, the rents in that neighborhood are $800 to $1,000, maybe even more, depending on how nice the house is fixed up. I mean, that's just excellent return on investment. That's amazing. I didn't spend, and I know people, you know people who have rental properties. They paid $120, $110, $90, twice as much, three times as much as mine, and they're making $800 or $750. What's to me, I know you might be in a nicer, classier neighborhood. Classier, you know, neighbors don't even know who they are. I don't know what's classy about that. You might be in that quote-unquote higher-end neighborhood, but you're making no money. And you get appreciation slowly, but so do I. Except I don't stress at night if no one's in that house that, you know, I'm invested $40,000 into. You can wait a month or two if that happens. However, the fact of the matter is, from my experience, in those neighborhoods, they need people. The people who rent aren't necessarily people who are going to be homeowners. I would say that I have noticed that there's a preponderance of, before you even finish your house, you are going to get calls. I have started working this house 3 weeks ago. I've gotten 2 phone calls. I have a no trespassing sign with my phone number. That is the reality. It's super quick turnover. It seems to be the nicer the house, the nicer, quote unquote, or the more expensive the neighborhood, the longer you have to go before you get a renter, especially if you're trying to get something that's at basically what the mortgage is on those houses. So it's funny. So not only do I get way more renters and a lot more people to choose from, you know, the cash flow, you know, instead of paying $800 a month in mortgage and, you know, getting $850 in rent and being half through with your $50, you know, if I finance most of it, you know, I'm making the minimum payments until the payments are due. But I mean, your monthly overhead expenses with taxes can be like $150, $200 at the top end. And, you know, you're making $900 a month in rent. So it's amazing. It's fantastic. And people thought I was crazy when I started this 4 years ago. And now, me and those same people talk, and they're super proud of me. They have not done the same, or they have, but they're not getting the returns that I'm getting. If I wanted to stop right now at this third house, so right now I get about $1,500 a month after property management fees from the 2 houses that are rented, and that $1,500 goes directly into paying off any of the bills coming due for the Richmond house that I'm fixing up. and then that should be done in about a month. If I took everything, if I just stopped there at that third house and didn't finish the fourth one that's across the street from the revitalization effort in Baltimore, I would have about, conservatively, let's say $2,200 a month in income. Even if I didn't do anything else and I didn't have the one house a year for the next 10 years, that's $2,100 a month. And that's after fees, you know. That's amazing. What can you do with that? What can you do if you took, as I tell people, what do you make? Do you make 30,000 a year, 40? If you make 50, 60, 70, 80,000 a year and goes up, live off half your paycheck. Live off half your paycheck and that other half, save up half your paycheck to pay for a real estate investment. Work hard for 4 years. So that's what I'm going to give you. I hope you're interested. You will know how to... You will definitely know how to put in the equity. You will know how to size up an investment very well. And even if you don't do my house, my strategy of 30K and under, and you do 40K or 50K, I should be able to help you and give you the confidence to go forward in a very thorough way, answering all the questions that I know you may have had, that I've had the same questions on and during your real estate investment. So thank you for tuning in. Please do not forget to like and go into your Google account, sign in and like if you do appreciate what I'm giving you as far as this is concerned. So thank you very much, and that's it.
Everybody get up.